Hello, I'm Ed Barker, and I'm here to tell you about a transcription book that I wrote. I transcribed all the solos of my favourite saxophone player in the world, Nigel Hitchcock, and I put them all in a book. And the book was endorsed by Jamey Aebersold and sold in his online shop. In fact, he's got a nice little quote there on the front saying what he thinks of it. And what you're about to hear is me playing one of the transcriptions in the book. It's a solo called Sunday to Saturday, and it's a Take That record, so a 1995 hit single, and I'm playing along with the original record, and then what I'm going to do for you is go through the solo. I'm going to show you the notes, and I'm going to show you all the interesting bits of Nigel's solo and harmonically analyze it for you. Now, of course, if you click the links in this video, you'll be taken through to a page where you can actually download this transcription. And you can hear the original recording as well. So make sure you watch out for that link when it comes. But here's me playing Sunday to Saturday, the Take That song, and the solo of Nigel Hitchcock. So here's the music for All Week Long, which you've just heard me playing. Now, All Week Long is the name we called this solo in the book, but it's based very closely, if not exactly, on the Take That solo that Nigel did on the Take That tune Sunday to Saturday. So dig that out and have a listen. It's one of the most one of the longest saxophone solos I've ever heard in a mainstream pop record. And it was, I don't think Nigel ever knew, and neither did the producer, Steve Anderson, who I spoke to about this. They never knew it was all going to be left in. So you can actually kind of hear Nigel becoming more and more experimental as the solo progresses, because he just thought it was going to be faded out way before that point. But it ended up staying in right to the end. So it's a really interesting solo to look at, because it has elements of pop in it, but also elements of jazz, but elements of jazz in a pop context. So let's look at it now. As you can see, this isn't like a jazz chart. There are there's not a huge amount of changes. The changes are actually the same all the way through. So it's an 8-bar sequence, and you have G major, F sharp major, B major, and you repeat that again. And then it's G major, F sharp major, and then essentially just G sharp minor for that bar there. Obviously the bass notes change. And then again, G, F sharp, B. And if you look through the solo, it's the same 8-bar phrase the whole way through. So Nigel had to really be inventive and make sure he didn't duplicate his language across this solo. And as you'll see in a minute, he really didn't. He delivered so much amazing stuff in this solo. So the first bit I want to look at is just bar four. So even 4 bars into the solo, Nigel is using over the B major triad, the B major chord there. He's using the F natural, which doesn't immediately fit with the B major triad, but it's actually the sharp 11. So he gets that nice sharp 11 sound. So it shows that you can use jazz harmony in a pop context without fearing. So that's an interesting thing. Again, bar 7, that's really kind of bluesy stuff, using the D natural at the top, really kind of pushing towards the B major triad in the next bar and treating the whole bar 7 and 8 almost like a whole blues section in B major. So that's an interesting thing. Growls, as you'll see in bar 10, we'll get onto, I'll look at effects and growls on the saxophone in a separate lesson. But the bit I really love, and the hardest bit to really pull off in this solo, is the next section, which starts in bar 12 on the B major chord, and extends all the way up. If you see it, it goes all the way up the range of the instrument, up to the top A sharp in bar 14. That's my favorite phrase from this solo. And if you can get that, then you really are ahead of the game. Now I'm gonna do a lesson on harmonics. So I'll give you the exact harmonic fingerings that I use, which work for me every time. They make me bang in tune, and they never fail me. So I'm going to give you the exact fingerings that I use, on that. I use the same fingerings for everything. They work across the board, whatever you're faced with. So they're really good fingerings to use. Bar 15 is an interesting one because on the F sharp chord, he starts there on a D natural. Now, if you imagine the F sharp there as an F sharp 7 chord, call it the dominant fifth chord of the B major coming up in the next bar. That means he's actually starting on the sharp 5 of the F sharp 7, which, as you probably know, as we discuss on the Learn the Language Jazz Harmony course at Ed Sax School, is the altered note. That's the one note that makes the diminished scale an altered scale, because actually you don't need two separate scales for the altered scale and the diminished scale, because they're actually very similar scales. The only difference is that altered note, and that's that sharp 5 note. So there, using the altered note over the F sharp triad, and then essentially locking back onto the diminished scale all the way down to the B, but instead of landing on a normal note for the B, he actually teases the listener by landing on an F, again, the sharp 11, which is really interesting. Then he does a nice little staccato passage, which I just think is just such a great thing to do, because he's just had this long, slurred section going up to the top of the instrument, wailing around, and then it gives you a sense of space in the solo by having the staccato there. So I really like that. Let's turn over the page. Of course, then in bar 25, he's using in the last on the last two beats that nice chromatic section. That's very reminiscent of someone he listened to called Chris Hunter, and of course Michael Brecker as well. So there's some early influences there coming out in Nigel's playing. Now, once you hit bar 26, I'm sure this is the point that Nigel thought it was never going to be used, and he started playing some really inventive stuff. Again, lots of the use of the sharp 11. Which is why the solo sounds so interesting. If you see there, F natural in bar 28. And he starts to use, over the F sharp chord especially, some really interesting triads. Now on the Learn the Language Jazz Harmony course at Ed Sax School, what we do is we actually deconstruct the diminished scale, and we look at it, instead of as a scale, we look at it instead as a series of major triads. And the two crucial major triads that make a dominant seventh chord sound so good are the triads that start a minor third below the root of the dominant seventh and a further minor third below that. So say it was a C7, you'd take the A major triad and the F sharp major triad. But here we're going to treat the F sharp as the seventh. So you do go a minor third below the F sharp, which is E flat, so E flat major, and then a minor third below the E flat is C, C major triad. So there's a few dotted around. You'll see on the F sharp chord that there's some notes. Say, let's have a look at bar 29. Do you see that G there over the F sharp chord and the E? So there's two notes from the C major scale. But where it's most apparent is in bar 31. You've got an A sharp there, you've got the G there, and up at the top you've got a D sharp. That's effectively an E flat major triad. And then you've got the C there, the G there, and the E there, which is a C major triad. So you've got both triads there over that F sharp chord which he's effectively treating as an F sharp 7 leading into the B major triad here. So that's why that chord sounds so out. You know, some people say, how do you start sounding out? Well, you don't need to be completely and utterly random to sound great. You actually just need to get some basic rules and just think about chords and think about the diminished triads that go along with each of the dominant seventh chords, and then you'll sound great. So there's a great example in bar 31 of using those major triads. And then he starts using the blues scale a lot, the B blues scale, as he heads towards the end of the solo. Great blues lines in bar 38. And then a lovely phrase in bar 39. Again, I'm sure that's because he's using the diminished triads. So yeah, there's the D sharp, the G, and the, gonna prove it, there's the A sharp. So there's hints of the E flat major triad over it there. There's a C there, a G there, an E there. So there's diminished triads all over the place. And if you really want to get to grips with that phrase there, because that's probably my favorite phrase other than the bit that goes right up to the top A sharp, it's probably worth taking that phrase and building that into a 2-5-1 phrase of your own. And starting to, so then you'll get that vocabulary into your, into the way you approach a solo. So I think I might actually take bar 39, construct a 2-5-1 phrase, and see if I can start using that myself. Then it gets really bluesy towards the end. Nice growl on the last note, going up to the top A. Growls I'll cover in another lesson, and harmonics I'll cover in another lesson. So don't worry about that. Let me know if you've got any problems with any of this harmonic analysis. Of course, if you want the handouts, the backing tracks, the copies of the solos, the original recordings, free lessons and all sorts of other things, just come to edsaxschool.com and sign up there, and you'll get all that stuff emailed to you. And also ask me any questions you've got there over at edsaxschool.com as well. I'm here to help and to impart the knowledge that I've been lucky enough to learn along the way. So I'll see you there. So I hope that was useful. Please head on over to edsaxschool.com, where you'll be able to grab your copy of the solos of Nigel Hitchcock, and you'll be able to get those free transcriptions that we mentioned as well. Find Ed Sax School on Facebook. It's facebook.com/edsaxschool, where I'll be posting other videos of the transcriptions from this book as well. And let me know what you think of the book and of this lesson by getting in touch. So I look forward to seeing you very soon. I'm Ed Barker from edsaxschool.com. Bye-bye.